So we're going to be streaming today and we're going online. So hello to everybody online. And we're also going to be streaming into the Hill because we will be having parallel sessions at some time. So welcome to all our community and everybody online. Please join in. Please tweet us. You know, the hashtag is DisruptEdu. Send us your questions, contact us, please join in. So we've got a great program for you today. You can hack your smartphone, you can flip the classroom, you can do circuit training. We've got a slam poet, who's also a teacher. We've got the student pitching session, which was really popular last time. That's our last session of the day. We've also got the student union doing a session and our projects team. There's lots of things to look at. We've got displays and we've got exhibition. So the theme today is intrinsic motivation. So what motivates you to learn? And to kick us off, we've got a man who is very, very interested in what motivates students to learn. So please welcome our boss, Deputy Vice Chancellor Ian Dunn.
I'm told I'm here to do a welcome. Thank you. I hope that everyone's had the coffee. It's really, really quite disruptive. it's a bit frothy. Well, welcome, particularly welcome to those external guests. You're most welcome in Coventry. I'm delighted to have you here. But also welcome to all of our colleagues and friends and students later, particularly. From my point of view, I think everyone knows that I'm particularly interested in how we actually translate this into the mass classroom and how we go from the project into 25,000 students, and not just 25,000 students here, but 25,000 students here and around the world and online and face-to-face and so on. And how do these things interact and how these things come together? So I'm really particularly pushing hard, and I'm going to make this as public as I always do. Sorry, Jonathan. But the flipped bit of this, the work that's going on in the DMLL is really, really important. It's really important not just from that sort of theoretical idea that we are developing something interesting. It's about how the interesting becomes mass and whole scale, and how we actually translate that, and what it does to the academic year, and how it changes those boring bureaucratic processes that the DMLL really don't want to think about, but really have massive impact on what happens in the design of our courses. Sorry to drop down into those sorts of levels of detail, but unless we get the whole picture from the way in which we create our courses and the way in which we engage our students in the conversations that create our courses, all the way through to engaging our students as alumni in the development from the other end of the scale, then it's just not going to work. Any one of those parts, any one of those aspects of the quality assurance process or the module review process or whatever that don't work and we don't understand, we will fail. We've been really successful over the last few years, and I think we've been really successful because we have started to look at our students not just as things that pay a fee, but we actually see our students as part of our communities, and we really are trying to create communities of learning and communities of practice, and giving that some sort of embodiment, not just a phrase that we use fairly loosely. And that linked to flipped learning and linked into the way in which we structure the academic year is all starting to come together. Now we have that really difficult bit to do. And that difficult bit is about making it real and actually bedding it into everything we do and not into the nice projects, which are great fun, but we have to, translate into mass. If we could do that, then we've achieved something really special. So we're on the cusp of something really fantastically special, and that's down to great innovation. Thank you very much. Now on. And we've got to proselytise, and we've got to convince the rest of the community. So instead of having 50 people here or 60 people here, next time we want 600 people here, please. from across the university and across the wider community. So have a great day, but please, if you could, all the way through the day, think about how you're going to take this these fantastic ideas into the mass. And then if you've got the answer, if you could write it down on a postcard or something, send it in. Sorry, a postcard's not disruptive. Sorry, if you could tweet. So you've got 140 characters. And over to Jonathan, who's itching to get onto this microphone because I've taken far too much time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ian. Ian has that ability just to show up and kind of say something kind of both intelligent, inspiring, and I, however, have to kind of use my brain and get what is in here, kind of thinking a little bit more. So I think the first thing I wanted to do was to ensure today you each introduce each other. I was going to go around and get the lab to introduce, but Ian, as he kindly pointed out, is we're running a little bit behind schedule, and because we've got a number of people following us online, I want to ensure that we get that opportunity. So if you haven't met somebody before today, please make sure that you do introduce, and everybody inside the lab, we are a growing and an evolving kind of group, please make sure you say hello to new people and new faces, because I think later on, you know, we're still a little bit early for some of our students, so later on the day will become increasingly populated, you know, for us perhaps when we get to the afternoon it dies down, for our students the afternoon suddenly gets busy. So, you know, we're on different time zones. But, you know, Ian talked about this idea that we have 60 people here. Last year, this for me is my recollection of last year, and it's essentially a Twitter sphere kind of visualisation, courtesy of Martin Hawksey. That's how I like to think of some of the things that we're doing here, that the legacy of a physical event can go much, much further than that and beyond kind of the boundaries of this university. So, you know, I was thinking, right, last year we introduced the lab, what it is that it does, and then, you know, people will always know that I often kind of use my children in my slides. So meet Josh, who's now 10, and this was when he was dressing up to be me. He was going to be a teacher for the day. So clearly, I take all of my kind of my fashion sense from him. But at the same time, he then sort of said, so, you know, what is it as a teacher that you do? Now, Ian and Sean have heard me kind of use this little analogy before, but I was then thinking, blimey, you know, we've got an intrinsic motivation, what motivates us, and suddenly I felt so demotivated with everything that I was doing at that moment in time. Because then he kind of put this little bit in, why? You know, I know why I do these things, you know, he doesn't realise the house that we live in costs money, he doesn't know all of these bits and pieces. And I went to that, you know, at that moment in time, my life was kind of dominated by, how do I get my inbox down beyond 20,000 unread emails? Yeah, it's nigh on impossible. Then I was thinking, well, I came to this university because I like cameras, you know, my background's photography and I like getting my hands dirty. Ah, photography is no longer about the apparatus, this skill, this knowledge that we need to have to pass on when we get into that environment. And then I thought, yeah, but the university says we must do this thing that's called research. So in other words, I must be intellectual, I must be kind of a real thinker, but for me that meant I do practice. So for me, practice, research was about this engagement with a particular media form, which was going through an evolution, and I loved, and this was my kind of passion, creating these kind of, how I now describe them, as long, blurry photographs. So really, truly intellectual. And then I was thinking, so right, you know, Ian's just described this scenario. We have these physical encounters, and they often are very privileged kind of moments. But most of my time, I spend kind of in this sort of scenario where somebody's trying to hide their face on a Skype conversation or a Google Hangout. And this particular moment, you know, recently, I mentioned at the beginning, the lab is evolving, we're growing. I think we've got 7 new people joining us over the next kind of couple of months. And in one of these such conversations that was really broken up, as Skype conversations often are, and I then fill in my evaluation that says, yes, it was broken up. Was it a pain in the arse? Yes, it was. Somebody used this term authentic. And I just thought, you know, they wanted to come to join the lab. They wanted to leave Italy. They wanted to come to the UK, transform their whole life, bring their cat with them, and they use this term authentic. And I just thought, that's quite an interesting thought. From that, I then, does anyone know who this young lady is? I'm hoping I'm not just the last one. Does anyone recognise this lady's face? I feel like I'm late to the game, so clearly you lot are later than me. But perhaps you maybe recognise her more like this. Yeah? somehow, I don't know how, I came across this, as we often do when we're sort of evolving through our search and what we're trying to learn ourselves. And I came across this. So I was probably 4 million, nine, you know, I was pretty much at the end of this list. So I feel quite late into this stage. But what is it that adults can learn from kids? You know, that's this state. That's that moment when Josh asked me, what do I do and why? And there's, again, in this talk and some other talks that she went on to do, she used this term authentic. So what do we mean by authentic? Perhaps somebody like Joey Ito, who, again, is kind of, perhaps for me, an aspiration of where we should see the things that we're trying to do here when I come from a media department. That sense of what they were doing around media, shifting it from newspapers and broadcast and television into that space, you know, when we're talking kind of in the 80s, 90s, not, you know, as we, Sean and I, who was here a moment ago, were thinking when we were doing this kind of 15 years ago, we were thinking, we're great. You know, this guy was talking about teaching happens to you, but learning is perhaps something that you kind of choose. I can see Jacqueline getting a little bit nervous here. He's going on. So today we're sharing all of these conversations through Disrupt Edu. So again, we can consider what these visuals, this ongoing conversation can be. So if you want to aggregate your stories, your conversations, the things that are interesting to you, please use that. The lab sees itself, so this is another slide I use at many occasions, in terms of our role. What is it that we're here for? Ian's described kind of the university's mission. For me, I think, you know, we should be something and different things to many different people. So it is about instigating this sense of change, catalyzing new opportunities, connecting people together, incubating kind of what might happen in some of these project rooms. And importantly, how do we amplify and make that change sort of stick? So my last thing, I promise, Jacqueline. Has anybody come across John Maeder, who again came from, was kind of at MIT, when I was kind of doing my funny camera things, I was interested in this idea of kind of visual languages and what that means. So these are visualizations taken from data. And more recently, I've been reading kind of Joanna Drucker's book, something or other. It's basically about the visual visual interpretation of information. So again, when I look at this, you know, I describe this. This is the thing that I often use to sort of describe what is the lab? How does the lab exist? What is it about? But actually, it's wrong, because what that is simply doing is displaying an information. It is displaying something past. It isn't displaying something future. It isn't displaying kind of change, because what it is doing is taking data and representing it. And in this book, so literally, all you've got to do if you pick up Joanna's book is graphesis. Is pick up that book, open to the first double page spread, so you know this is the level of my intellect, you might say, is, and you'll encounter this diagram. And what we have here from the 1600s is a visualization which is about producing knowledge that it draws. So it's not about something fixed. This is about something that grows and something that evolves. So for me, this is what I would hope inspires the lab to kind of move forward. Thank you.
Jonathan, before we carry on, does anybody need a seat up here? Because we've got a few people around there. Does anybody want to come and sit in here? Okay, there's plenty of seats over here. Okay, so, okay, thank you. If everybody wants to have a little shift around, you can do. So, now it's the time for our keynote speaker, Paul Ranson. After this session, we are going to split into parallel sessions. But I'd like to introduce Paul. I've known him quite a long time. I worked with him at Serious Games International and also on the BT project. Paul's made over 300 video games, most of them for entertainment, some of them serious. He's been an executive with very good tech companies such as Codemasters and Eidos, Slam Productions and Serious Games International, and he's run his own business. He's a really interesting guy, good speaker, and a very original thinker. So, Paul.
Thank you. Oh, is this the clicker? Right. How do you do? Hello, everybody on the hill and in internet land. Hi, my name's Paul, and I'm an entrepreneur. I'm here today to explain a few things about how I've learnt my entrepreneurial skills through the years. And I thought I'd start off by being a bit wacky and zany by just having a headline that Murphy's Law sucks. Murphy's Law explains that if something can go wrong, it will go wrong. It was kind of invented by some American pilot, I think, in an attempt to be funny, but has been taken on by an awful lot of people who develop things to manage the way that they work. Murphy's Law to me is something that is a rule that just says stop. Murphy's Law tries to get you to consider all the options before embarking on a project. But I say Murphy's Law sucks. I say, did the disruptive innovators of Airbnb, Uber, Facebook consider all the options before they started? I think not. Murphy's Law to me is something that experts have used to procrastinate before actually starting. I think it's an old-fashioned concept that misunderstands the speed at which ideas can be created into something real and something that you can touch. Disruption is the name of the game these days. But how do you learn to disrupt? Over the course of my keynote, I'll explain a few approaches that I've made in my career to make new stuff. So I'll start off by being disruptive to this conference. I'd like to invite, I'm going to take you three ladies, to do something interactive. Also on the Hill, I've got somebody who should be on the sidelines that's also helping as well. I wonder if you could take to the stage. Ooh. All right. I've got a scrap piece of paper. You can sort of be looking up at the camera. Right. Hopefully the people at the Hill have got something similar as well. So what I'd like you guys to do is to get this piece of paper as far away from this stage as you can in the next 2 minutes. Yep, you've got 2 minutes. Well, I didn't completely expect that. I suppose that's disruptive in its own right. We should get them to give us a call. Have you done it yet? So I don't know what's happening at the Hill. You can come back now. Oh, they're gone. Okay. You can come back now. I don't know. Oh well, they've gone. That's okay. It's another good way to clear the floor. Aha! What? How far did you get?
I was heading out of the building. But I had a different idea.
Yeah.
It was just to tweet it.
Yeah, okay. What, tweet the piece of paper?
Tweet the piece of paper.
Okay. How far did you get?
Showed the camera.
You showed it the camera?
Oh,
fair enough. Again, you didn't quite get the hearing. And how far did you get?
I put mine in the lift and sent it down.
Well, what I'm going to do is to slide
mum
for X-Men. Well, I guess Sylvester is. Could you give that to Sylvester, please? He's going to take that to Malaysia when he's Christmas. So, thank you very much for doing that. Okay, what I tried to do there was to try and be funny as much as be educational. There's more than one solution to getting a better hand, and I've got to say they were really cool ideas. At the heart of what I'm trying to do is to show you that as a disruptor, you need to be exploiting blind spots in people's thinking, and you ladies have surely done that, but hopefully the people on the Hill have done the same. So, my disruptive idea alert. I'd like you to think, when you're thinking in disruptive thoughts, about being a confidence tricker. You need to study the rules and bend, but don't break them. You've got to work out what's not been said, which is what you guys did, and take that to your advantage, and then apologise for the disruption that you make in the process. In my life, I'm always looking for angles, like a business version of Ronnie O'Sullivan, his snooker player. So the chances of making a career out of putting bits of paper onto the other side of the stage or in the lift, they're fairly slight. So let me describe some of the real life disruptions that I've made in my career. So as Jacqueline pointed out, I've been a video game entrepreneur for nearly 30 years now, possibly more actually if I add it up. And in my life, I've developed, say, nearly 300 video games. And the story I just thought I'd start to explain now is one that's actually quite close to my heart. And in 2009, after 12 years of running my business, I did a bad business deal and I found I had to fold my games business. It was a very stressy moment for me because I'd as every entrepreneur, I'm not sure how many are in the room or in internet land, will understand, it's like you've got a baby that you're trying to keep going or trying to make mature and things. So anyone wanted to find out more about it, I've written very passionate blog posts about it on my LinkedIn profile. But you can't keep a good man down. If you cut me in half, which I don't want you to do, you'll find digital entrepreneur written through me like a piece of Blackpool rock. So what was I going to do? I had a dwindling cash resource, a reputation for only making one game. What I'm not actually explaining is I intended to make golf and tennis games. And in the creative industries, you'll find you're only as good as the last game that you've ever done. So I had no code base. I had not as many staff in my control. In short, my career as being a digital developer was basically at startup level again. Have I done something with the screen? Okay, super, thank you. So what was I going to do next? I realised I couldn't simply just do what I'd been doing before, as that would be stupid. Einstein said that doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results is a definition of insanity. Life had given me a very valuable, and it has to be said, expensive lesson. The sort of business I was doing sucked, and I needed to change. I needed to disrupt. What the heck is disruption? Well, disruption to me is where a commercial idea smashes into a set of normal thoughts and comes up with a solution that's not been considered before, but most crucially is valuable. Just like the Pixar movie Inside Out, inside me I've got two personalities that are competing for my attention. They fight for my entrepreneurial attention, is what I meant to say. I categorise this fight as the fight between the inner nerd, a design and digital dude, and a bean counter that's my internal accountant. Now both sides of me has a reasonable set of considerations. But they approach the business from two opposing views. In neuroscience, I understand, this is called the convergent and divergent thinking. To be a disruptor, I need to set these two opposing characters for a Harry Hill-style fight. But what do I mean by these contradictory thoughts? I'd like to explain the two different types of thinking that we're going to set on course for a collision course to become an innovative thinker. Convergent thinking is one that's based on stuff that we already know. It's the champion of the status quo, and it's kind of safe thinking. The team in the accounts department tends to be made up of people that are like convergent thinkers. In my career, I found that focus groups interviewed as a herd will drift into convergent thinking. My experience of getting a group of kids together to help design a video game will generally, they'll have a description of the game that they've just played, but this time with a bigger gun. As Henry Ford said, if I'd have asked my customers what they wanted, they'd have just said, a faster horse, please. And when Guy Kawasaki, who, and his team that was developing the first Apple Mac, when he went round and did interviews with the digital game dudes of the time, all they asked for was a faster MS-DOS PC. Divergent thinking is the opposite of convergent. It champions the absurd and tries to come up with an idea in a way that no one's thought about before. It challenges all the assumptions that convergent thinking has. I wonder if anyone remembers a time before Netflix. It was, I don't know, possibly only about 3 years ago. it's in my lifetime, anyway. So this was a time when you used to walk, remember that, to the DVD shop. Let's call it Blockbuster. You'd happily queue, happily, for half an hour to take your DVD home. And then you'd forget to post it back and get charged extra for late delivery. So now, if you can try and transpose yourself back, well, 3 or 4 years ago, anyone suggesting that you could download a movie would have asked to feel the bumps on your head. It's something that, you know, that I sort of put on it was like being a blind man, so it's back to this blind spots thing, and it would sit in the central reservation of a motorway thinking, that's, nothing's coming, it's a juggernaut. The CEO of Blockbuster is actually quoted as saying that neither Redbox or Netflix are on the radar screen in terms of competition. He said that just before he got hit by a juggernaut that was called Netflix. So how do you get these divergent thoughts, Paul, is what I hear you say. Maybe not. I get my divergent thoughts when I'm trying to be funny or silly. According to the actor John Cleese, when you're being creative, nothing is wrong. When you're being funny, divergent thoughts pop in and out of your head all the time. When comedians make jokes, we think that they're funny. But if you take the sort of imaginations that people apply jokes to, then maybe you could get an insight into what is to be innovative. So to me, another definition of innovation is the art of applying foolishness to your thinking. Let me tell you a story. I need a quote for a long ago. It's from a TED lecture that I saw that Guy Kawasaki is a bit of a fanboy for. It's about these dudes called ice harvesters. Around the turn of the 19th century, people actually made a living carving huge lumps of ice from frozen lakes in North America. In fact, they did some in the UK as well. They'd store them in a little cave underground that was quite cool. And then, like, when it got hot again in the summer, they'd take these lumps of ice to the city and sell them for a profit. So here's another picture of them looking, carving the things up. Yeah, amazing thing. All the innovation at the time was focused on the development of ideas that could shift the ice to the city at speed. So they replaced motorised the tractors in to replace horse and carts, and then eventually put train tracks in to get the ice to the ice fields quicker, to the city quicker. And businesses would be organised to get from the station to the customers. Then some bright spark thought a foolish thought. Let's make a machine that makes ice and situate it close to the city. This building here is actually a building that was just created to bake big lumps of ice. These ice houses, as they were called, were created when they froze ice at an industrial scale. And in one move, these disruptors laid waste to all of the innovations that had occurred prior to that. So all the transportation network and the infrastructure that had been so carefully put together was considered to be a waste of time. So as I said before, at the time, industrial fridges, you know, were huge, massive things. They used ammonia to do something clever with the freezing process. Now, ammonia is a pretty scary chemical to have around, and it was treated with a great deal of respect because, frankly, it could kill you. However, in 1920, chlorofluorocarbonation was developed by some fool thinking he could actually put something as deadly as a fridge in everyone's home. In one sweep, he managed to smash all the ice house businesses and laid waste to yet another industry that considered itself invulnerable. At every junction of this sorry tale of ice industry, there were people spouting innovation that they were considered just idiots. They were considered like a foolish comedian, almost. So, how do you go about creating ice-breaking divergent ideas? Well, the first thing that most people do is say, right, okay, we'll sit around in a table and we'll gather a heap of people and we'll do a brainstorm. And I'm sure you can imagine our very disruptive opinions about this too. I have to say, I'm in the camp that thinks brainstorming sucks. My advice, frankly, is don't do it. The basic tenets for a brainstorm are to generate as many ideas as possible. Don't criticise other people's stuff. Welcome unusual and daft ideas, and combine and improve ideas in a collaborative environment. I think there's a problem with this sort of meeting. No team can come up with an innovative idea from a standing start. Sit seven or so random people in a room and ask them to be creative, and you'll really be onto a non-starter. I feel that people are not wired to be creative on demand, and don't get me started on thinking out of the box cliches. By collecting a diverse set of people from around your business, it's likely that they'll all really know one another. And remember, an idea that's not been thought of before is going to sound crazy. For people to voice crazy requires a heap of social confidence that might not simply be there, and particularly in a British company. So then, smart ass, what's your answer to this? What I think you need is a set of icebreaker games. What you're doing is you're trying to look for the blind spots that people have about their current thinking. Now, the game that I like to play is kind of based on a concept called misère. So misère is a term used in card games. It's where you take a standard game and you deliberately attempt to lose. So my disruptive idea alert is, don't ask your team to come up with a new product idea. Challenge them to work out the ways to make the company or product you're developing worse. While it seems counterintuitive, you'll find that within your cohort there's going to be some wannabe comedian that'll grasp this concept. And if not, come to the meeting armed with a few funnies to see the game. When running this game, I found that the question quickly resorts into an extremely hilarious exercise. When was the last time you laughed at a brainstorm? The side effect of this process is that your team will expose deep-rooted issues that indicate areas of pain. These are the blind spots that you're looking for to exploit and disrupt. So if you hold one of these meetings, be vigilant. Observe these, you know, bittersweet comments that are occurring in your meeting. The subliminal messages from your team for areas that you need to concentrate on. So some people take a look at my career in video games, San Francisco, Tokyo, New York, and go, you've really got it made. That's living all right. But do you know what? I actually don't play games. I stopped playing games when I was about 18. There was, in fact, a time when I deliberately unsettle a cosy chat with my video game friends and tell them I actually hate games. Now, part of this reason, as I'm sure you're guessing, is I try to be an amateur comedian. I try to shake things up deliberately and be disruptive. It's kind of part of my inner psyche. But there's another reason for it. I am not my customer. Disruptive idea alerts. I should have numbered these. This disruptive idea is, basically, don't make stuff that you're absolutely passionate about. Do things that are on the outlines of your passion that you know loads of other people are really passionate about. To me, passion is a side effect of mastery. The acquisition of mastery, as my gamification chums will tell you, is actually the definition of fun. I seriously urge you not to change your hobby into a career. In fact, in a fight between your hobby and your work, work will win. This will take your passion down, and let me spell it out. If you set yourself up to follow this passion that you currently have, you are less likely to succeed. I say this based on experience. Here's a couple of examples I have of outlying passions that I've run to became successful businesses. Car handbooks. Now, I know nothing about cars, but like many blokes, I like them. I like the design, I like the shapes, I like the noises they make, and I love watching shows like Discovery Channel's Wheeler Dealers, where they take old vehicles and do them up to sell them. Well, personally, I don't like tinkering with engines, because I have an aversion to getting oil under my fingernails. This, then, is an outlying passion. With this ammunition, I made an internet business selling books about Japanese grey imported cars. My passion for this business came not just from the cars, but from setting up an environment of marketing on the websites. This is something that I've never done before. It chimed with my passion for digital development, and I optimised and fiddled with the site over and over again, like I would have done with a video game. Yet at the time, all I knew was I was learning about cars. I got to learn about stuff that I'd never knew about before. Engine parts, turbochargers, big ends, camshafts. Networking with these sort of people that were interested in this was actually very easy, because they thought they were talking to someone that should have known better. Mr. Greenhouse. In winter, I tend to watch BBC Gardener's World every week. This is generally the exact moment when I can't do anything in a garden. Frankly, my phobia about getting dirt under my fingernails cuts in as well. But I do like the idea of gardening. This then is another outlying passion. With this ammunition, I made another internet business selling greenhouses that I could distribute through the country using DHL. This time, the passion was ignited by setting up and marketing on eBay. Yet again, charmed with my digital development industry, and I optimised and fiddled with the structure of adverts and images along the way, I learned about gardening. But how did I disrupt the games business? My first port of call was to consider disrupting my internal thinking. My games business was focused on the production of golf games. I'd figured that focusing on a niche would mean I'd become the go-to resource for these sorts of games. I was disruptive because I was super cheap. But my entire budgets were at the fraction of the cost of even entertaining the industry leader was Tiger Woods' golf game. As a smaller developer, I would often sneer at the big budgets that Electronic Arts and the like would have. And our games were also doomed to be second rate because of this. I realised after a period of reflection that I was just being a snark. And after a conversation that I had with one of the chaps at EA, He came up with this word authentic that Jonathan mentioned before. People play Tiger Woods because the games were authentic. I realised that my target market wasn't the publishers for which I've developed the games for cheaply, but was for the people playing it at the end. Players don't care how cleverly the game's been made, but they do recognise how authentic it is. But how could I compete with a $6 million budget that Tiger Woods had? What would a small indie developer with no money, no code base and no ideas do? My creative head went into overdrive. In my career, I've been involved in making decisions at a publishing company like Codemasters and Eidos. These were very big companies at the time. The big publisher blind spot was generally that they had to sell a $1 million game, otherwise they couldn't justify it. I realised that if I aimed smaller, then bizarrely my opportunities could be bigger. Disruptive idea alert. Think small. I decided to ditch the aspiration of being a global force and become the top-selling game just in the UK. I knew that most of the people in the business, and I knew that I could do a great job. Disruptive idea number two. Small companies can license titles too. I ditched my snarkiness towards licensed products. I realised I'd mischosen my target market by attacking the likes of Electronic Arts head on with my unauthorised, unauthentic product. I was bound to lose. I should therefore license something that EA would not have considered. My new focus. I focused my development of British TV game shows, the ones that the mega companies would not be interested in because of the overhead of managing their development. But I realised that in the UK, these shows were endemic. Everyone knew who they were. I also played pub quiz games every other week, and I realised that this was an outlying passion. I approached the television companies directly and made them an offer to develop the game as a joint venture. We used the authentic set, all the intro to the TV shows, and also the game hosts. The results were that in a 2-year period, my 4-man team made 36 versions of game shows, ranging from Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, which I'm sure you've heard of, to Golden Balls, which you haven't. And we worked with UK household names such as Jasper Carrots, Chris Tarrant, and Vernon Kay. In this talk, I've suggested that you think like a hustler. Exploit blind spots. Look for angles that competition haven't thought of and choose a battlefield that you can compete on. Come up with an innovative idea and challenge your team to think negatively, to think the worst possible idea, and then set about using this as the inspiration to improve the position. Don't follow your dream. Choose something that chimes with your passions that you can then bring to a different industry. Understand that you are not necessarily your customer. Before attempting to disrupt the world, disrupt your own thinking first. Work out your inner rule set and see if it chimes with other people's thinking. Disrupt your convergent thoughts and you are likely to be thinking divergently. But when in doubt, do something. Don't get stuck in Murphy's negative assumptions. Use the approach of iteration and make a start on whatever you're doing. As I hope I have explained, I've tried heaps of strategies in my time. Some of them have been wildly successful and others spectacular failures. I subscribe to the notion that it's better to have an interesting failure than a boring success. But always remember that your successes pay your mortgage. Thank you.
Thank you everybody in internet land as well for watching. So have we got any questions here? Some questions from the floor perhaps?
Yeah,
Okay, so while you're thinking, I'll just ask you, saying, mm-hmm. you say, don't follow okay. your dream then, Paul. So what is your dream that you don't want to follow?
What's my dream? My current dream that I'm following is I want to set up a chain of effectively bed and breakfasts like Airbnb. So I've got an idea to create a set of effectively one bedroom hotel rooms that I'll rent out using services with Airbnb.
Okay,
you heard it here first.
Well, we'll have to look out for that one. Okay.
Okay, so you're at a university, mm-hmm. and coming in here, what would you do to disrupt us that we haven't thought of?
Flipping it. I've got 2 minutes. well, I like the idea of flipped learning, but I think somebody's already thought of that. I don't really know at the moment. You have to give me a moment. I can think of ways of making it worse. Maybe make all the seating really hard and uncomfortable.
We've thought of that one. Okay. Any other questions?
Sort of going on from what Patricia said, mm-hmm. when you're looking for an employee for your business, particularly for a sort of slim startup, mm-hmm. what type of university graduate are you looking for?
I'm going to be disruptive again. I don't particularly look for university graduates. I look for passion first. And I've actually employed an awful lot of first-time individuals. I'm starting to flip that thinking. It has to be said as I get older. But historically, I found that if you employ somebody that is experienced, they come with a rock star mentality, certainly from my games business. And rock stars, they're really great if you can get them to work for you, but it's quite a challenge. And so I tend to want to work with, certainly in the video game business, guys, because they're usually guys, are desperate to get involved. And so I find that having given, possibly hundreds of people that opportunity, you find those gems, you find the superstars that then become your superstars rather than these rock stars that may think they're greater than they are. I sound a bit bitter there.
Any more questions?
Hi, David.
Hi, Paul. Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. And I think your life experiences pretty much mirror my own in terms of having had successful businesses and then things go pear-shaped.
Yeah.
My question really is about the importance of getting other people to buy into your disruptive ideas. Because I find increasingly that if you want to have a disruptive idea, particularly if it challenges people's thinking, then you have an immediate problem of getting people to buy in into your ideas. So how important do you think it is to get partners and people around you who buy into your thinking?
Yeah. It's insanely important, and it's kind of a challenge to be a leader. So I've been a good leader, I've been a bad leader, but on the whole, when you're chairing an innovation meeting, you need to come to it not armed with, I suppose, like I did today and you saw it go wrong. But you are trying to steer a ship and you try and be as egoless as you possibly can. And by not taking the lead role, there's always this word managing director or chairman or CEO, and there's the presumption that that fella is the person that makes the decisions and it's follow me. But in reality, modern business is about what I call flat management, and I've always called it flat management. People come to me and say, make a decision, Paul, and they don't present me with the information. So I tend to say, well, what would you do? And if that chimes, then you've got somebody that's invested in the idea because it's come from there. And it might come across a little bit as a confidence trick, but I've often sat in meetings where I'm itching to say, it's this, you idiots. But the moment you do that,
you've lost that first little chip of inspiration towards doing it.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, I always argue that the best leaders are what I would call followers, mm-hmm. People who can chime into the way that other people are thinking and see things from their perspective, and adjust ideas to fit in with what other people's motivations are.
Yeah. I mean, what again? I often use the analogy of a ship. When you're stuck in a tight corner that. You know, your team are saying we want to go that way, but we're heading that way. You know, we say, well, we'll nudge it. Well, you know, that's another management word at the moment, but we'll try and turn the ship towards that general direction. And that way you've got a team that are on side, because that is it's the definition of teamwork. You know, you're working together. You're not some tyrant that's saying this is the way you'll do it. It's just not. It's not how modern business works these days. You know, with your Generation Y, these people have grown up being equals, and you know, as people go on in the future, you've got to work a way of working with them. And I've been privileged in my career that from a very early age, I've worked with people that have been very talented and very equal, and I can see that as time goes on, that experience has scaled to mega corporations like Facebook and Google and things like that.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Paul.